Welcome. I would like to say hello to everyone. Welcome to Greenwich Associates Market Structure webinar for June 2020. I'm Shane Swanson. I'm in the Market Structure and Technology Group here at GA. We're incredibly fortunate to have an amazing panel today. Today, we're joined by Brett Redfearn, Director of Division Trading and Markets at the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, Joanna Fields, Founding Principal at Aplomb Strategies, and Mike Masone, Director and Head of American Equity Market Structure. With this panel, we don't want to waste any time, so there's a lot to cover. Let's get right into it. As everyone knows, markets and trading in general have been impacted by the coronavirus and the continuing efforts to handle that. So we want to take a look at what has happened there, what's going to happen in the future. We can look at examples of the exchange floors, which have closed and then reopened. We've seen changes in average daily market share on the NYSE, which started the year at almost 13% of ADV in the equities market. After and during the close, averaged a little under 11%. And since they have reopened on at least a smaller scale, have grown up about 11.25%. And we know tomorrow they're going to include even more with the reopening, bringing back some of their market makers. These are just small indications of what's happened in the market as we've adjusted to work from home. I'd like to throw it to the panel. What have been some of the biggest concerns as we've seen this shift from a normal market environment to what we've been dealing with today? Joanna, what are your thoughts on issues with surveillance, for example?
All right, good afternoon, everybody. My disclaimer is usually I can't control traders, but today, since we are working from home and talking about it, I currently can't control my puppy dog or 8-year-old. Who knows what will happen in this environment? All things considered, the U.S. capital market has been really very resilient and has held up remarkably well given the last few months, even if we've lost a few friends in the hedge fund world. As a derivatives girl, volatility in the market doesn't really raise very many alarm bells for me. However, parents working from home have to now balance teaching schedules. I am a terrible second grade teacher. Aging parents, potential job losses and revenues, and all of this type of volatility at once is a different story. So with regards to surveillance, the stability of a working from home environment, you know, you have to control your daughter's Zoom schedule versus, you know, being able to get online. Something to keep in mind is additional due diligence that's required to ensure that controls are working as designed. You can't walk over to your control room anymore to make sure that your controls are working. It's really hard to figure out, as I do most of your 15C35 exams and certifications every year, the recent market events, market-wide circuit breakers, this is the first time they've actually, that's very hard to test in a test environment, so they're now having to work, so that's going to be interesting. And has your BCPDR plan worked and has your surveillance systems kicked in? Surveillance modules actually just need to be tweaked. You have PII data that's now at home. You have traders that can't be supervised in person. And I think the most important thing that we've seen with some of the recent news around Robinhood is some of the limitations around existing communication and the communication surveillance tools. How are you actually capturing all of the different internet and applications that, you know, in different broadcast forms that people are using to track behavior at home? It's much more difficult, and everybody has access to their iPads and phones.
And Mike, what other issues should firms be looking at as they think about this new environment? In particular, not if it's just not a short-term event, but it may be something that lasts for the foreseeable future.
So there's a number, obviously, and maybe before I just jump straight to the regulatory, there's obviously commercial issues. There's obviously client relationship issues. How do you stay in front of clients? How do you kind of manage a world where all of us feel, even despite technologies like the one we're on now, all of us feel a bit isolated? Just by way of example, and one that I think doesn't get talked about all that often, I feel enormously privileged to be doing a webinar right now with two of the three biggest mentors I've had in my career. You know, Shane, from your days at Citi when you were running ATD for us, Shane was a huge contributor to Citi Views, which I've published for now 10 years. And Brett, from his time when he was, you know, prior to joining the SEC, when he was at JP Morgan, and we did a lot of work together on the SIFM Equity Markets and Trading Committee. I mentioned that because I think one of the biggest casualties of this whole work from home environment is really mentorship. You know, the financial industry is at its core an apprenticeship business. You know, you kind of come up through the ranks and you learn from those who have been there before you. And I think the biggest challenge that I see is for some of the younger folks in our organizations who are really missing out on a lot of that day-to-day interaction, face-to-face, you know, on-the-job training that you get. And I think that's extremely important for firms to keep an eye on and to find ways to keep that alive in an environment like this. And then to your point, Shane, if, you know, even after we all look forward to a day when we have a vaccine for COVID and we can get back to, you know, a more normal environment. But what is that new normal? You know, people keep talking about being pleasantly surprised by how the work from home setup has operated. You know, I think generally speaking, it's been quite a surprise on the upside for many of us. And so it would only be natural to expect that there will be some semblance of this that continues, be it in the form of maybe less business travel, more virtual meetings like the one we're doing now, which would hopefully lead to more efficiencies, you know, less wasted time, less time staring at screens and delayed flights and airports. You know, I think there's a lot of good that could come out of this, but then what does that mean from a regulatory perspective? And I think this is really in FINRA's court, and they've, you know, to their credit, they've issued some helpful guidance in the form of regulatory notices this year that are starting to think through some of the issues. But, you know, it runs the gamut, you know, from a sales perspective. What are we able to do and not able to do in an environment like this? What is considered a gift versus what is client entertainment? What's considered a branch office? And therefore, going forward, if we have multiple people working from home for some portion of their day, do firms have an obligation to visit those work from home environments as branches of their home office? There's a lot still to be figured out from both a commercial and a regulatory perspective. I think we're really just scratching the surface right now.
Well, I think that's a good segue, Brett. We want to make sure we tap into your knowledge, obviously. As you look at what has happened and where things may be going, what will be the primary focus of regulators, not only the SEC, but others you may talk to in the industry?
I mean, look, first, let me just say thank you for having me, and it's a pleasure to be here. Second, the views that I say today are mine and mine alone and not those of the commission or the commissioners or anybody else. I think, you know, to talk about just for a second, I want to do a kind of a positive spin on the question in particular, because what's most amazing to me is how well it's working and how efficient things have been. I think all of us continue to be, you know, pretty surprised by how productive people are, how much we're getting done, and how things continue moving, you know, regardless of the fact that we're all located in different places. So I think that's really important to point. An example would be, this is the third thing that I've done today, where in other circumstances, it would have never been possible because I would have had to travel to three different places to do it. And in some respects, there's incredible efficiencies that come from this. The other thing that I would just say is this, there's a lot of relief. I mean, I swear in March into April, you know, it seemed like, you know, at one point 90%+ of the job, and then, you know, gradually whittled down by April to maybe only half of the job. But it was all kinds of relief that we were giving, relief to help exchanges trade fully electronically, relief for, you know, no fingerprinting or physical certificates or you name it. There's a long list. And if anybody wants, there's a whole COVID web, you know, section of our website that talks about all the different areas of relief that we've granted. And, you know, and now we're at the point where it's gotten into, you know, what do we extend? But then there's also things like, wait a second, what are the things that maybe we should just keep? Right? What are the things that, you know, really maybe make sense more permanently? And again, these are not things that you know, it's still early to say, but to the extent that there's efficiencies involved in this, we want to think about what they are. And to the extent that things don't ever go back exactly the way they did before, there might be some things where, you know, we should be able to accommodate that. So I think part of how we're thinking are, what are the aspects of the changes that have been put in place that actually have proven themselves to make sense and that might be warranting of some sort of greater consideration going forward to bring the kind of efficiencies that we've seen in this process now?
Great. Are there areas where in things like market-wide circuit breakers where we've seen them implicated for the, or implemented for the first time, and there have been, I've heard at least, some concerns around how they were implemented, whether or not there should be harmonization between the equities and the futures circuit breakers? Is there an ongoing dialogue around those types of analyses that might be performed now that we have a little, well, maybe it's not normal, but we're beginning to see some reopening in the markets?
Sure. So look, you know, for those people who are, you know, students of markets and market microstructure, we just have an amazing amount of data that we can look at and things that, you know, that we can better understand. We have a whole, you know, regulatory infrastructure that has had, you know, the tires kicked very hard on a lot of different fronts. Our market-wide circuit breakers were tested for the first time and were tested four times. Our limit up, limit downs were hitting at record numbers. Short sell 201, we had days where there were over 6,000 triggers all happening in one day, right? We've seen how Reg SCI has come into play and a number of other things. And so I would say that, yes, on market-wide circuit breakers, we need to look at that. There's a task force that's been assembled that's sort of asking questions about, you know, should the market really halt at 9:30 in 1 second for 15, you know, minutes if people had all night to think about what they were going to do. On limit up, limit down, how, you know, what percentage of S&P names might have been triggered at the exact same time that might have impeded the updating of that index value and therefore impeded the way that we look at price formation in the index. Short sell 201, did it really help slow short selling? How well did it work? To what extent, you know, we had a lot of questions about, you know, should we have an alternative, should we have the uptick rule brought back? And we think that it generally worked pretty well, right? But then you have market makers who said there were so many names that were triggered at the same time or so many underliers in a given ETF that it made it hard for them to provide liquidity. So did it cause a widening of spreads and did it impede liquidity in some of those names? Margin models at clearing agencies, right? The way that margin was called at the clearing agencies, a lot of people have raised questions about, you know, whether it's too pro-cyclical and whether or not there should be, we should be thinking about, you know, how they worked exactly. And, you know, for the most part, you know, all of these things, in my view, function really well. There's nothing that we're like, you know, there's no burning, you know, we have to go out and deal with this right away, which is sort of the experience after the flash crash or after, you know, August 24th or other events. But nonetheless, we will certainly study, learn, and figure out what we should do.
And Brett, great. If I could.
No, please, Mike.
I would echo the positivity around, you know, the productivity that we're seeing. You know, I could say at our firm, and I think this has been pretty broadly agreed that people are very pleasantly surprised with the levels of productivity. I would just add to that my sense from the industry is that people are generally very pleased with the U.S. regulatory and other responses to the crisis. At the real depths of the market and the crisis itself in March, when we were having market-wide circuit breakers triggered four times, I often say to people, I'm most appreciative for what the SEC and for what U.S. regulators didn't do at those times than what they did. I felt like it was a very steady hand, a very calm approach to what was not anything but calm markets. And so, people were calling for market shutdowns, for shorter trading hours, for short sale bans akin to what was being done in other jurisdictions globally. And I think the fact that none of that really, not only wasn't it done, but it was pretty well telegraphed to the industry that that wasn't the direction that the SEC was taking. And I think that actually worked very well to calm markets. You know, we were quite concerned about reopenings after market-wide circuit breaker triggers, and they all the reopenings went just fine. You can argue that, yes, we should be harmonizing futures and cash equities triggers at 5 or 7%, but things worked really, really well, and I think there's a lot of credit to be given to you and the other folks in Washington for the responses.
And I think it's a testament really industry-wide, right? So after many of the past crises, we've made big investments both on the regulatory side, but then into the response from the industry, without which I don't believe we would have had as smooth and as liquid and active and effective markets that we did have, as Mike says, during the depth of that crisis. Let's turn the focus a little bit. Market data is in the spotlight for any number of reasons. Brett, I know there are a number of initiatives that the SEC has undertaken kind of under the umbrella of Reg NMS 2.0. And you know, of those, there's the rescission on effective upon filing for NMS plan fee amendments. There's the SIP filing on governance, and there's the SIP filing on infrastructure. So all taken together, that 2.0, are there any areas there that you would like to highlight? And then we can talk about some of the more recent activity in that area as well.
Oh, boy. So thanks for that question, Shane. I mean, look, there's a lot there, and so I'll try to keep it pretty high level. First thing I would just say is, for all the people that are engaging in the process, we really appreciate it, that we've gotten a lot of comment letters and a lot of engagement, and that's super helpful. So thanks for doing that, and please continue to do so. If people want to come in and meet with us and talk about things, we're still, not come in, but come in virtually and meet with us and talk to us about this. It's a lot easier. There's no travel involved, so it's very easy to set these things up, and we're happy to do so. So I would say that. At a high level, these are important issues. These are issues that have been around for a long time, and they're not easy. And tackling these things is a challenge. And so that level of engagement is very important. The effective on filing procedure is simply, a lot of this is about, these are important fees, and we think they should be out for notice and comment and let the public and let investors and let participants have an opportunity to engage in the process and to tell us how they feel and to provide input on those things, because they are controversial, and that is warranted. And sometimes when they just go immediately effective, and then there's people don't think that it's necessarily worth the time to do it, and say we don't get the same. I think we might not get the same level of engagement. We'll see. On SIP governance, right? This has been an issue again, right? We've got, we have very real concerns about the conflicts of interest that exist within the current governance model, because you have, exchanges, and they have great businesses, and they're very, real experts in market data and, and SIPs and so on and so forth, but they're also selling competing products. They're selling prop feeds, selling, both the depth of the book feed and then sort of a cheaper top of book feed. And those come in direct conflict with the SIP product. And so a lot of people have come to us and said, maybe that's one of the reasons why the SIPs have lagged so far behind in terms of speed and content, or maybe that's one of the reasons why, the governance hasn't panned out as well as it could. So we're trying to address that by really looking at the governance, looking at conflicts, looking at confidentiality of information that's being shared among businesses or even with the advisors, and looking at, ways in which we can broaden the participation in that governance so that more voices can come in and talk about how this should work, not solely one sort of segment of the industry. And then with infrastructure, it's, it's pretty straightforward. Like, the markets have evolved. It's fast, right? People need information, and they don't just need any more. Like, if you think about it, bid-ask, last sale, this is really a relic of like the late 1970s, right? And a proprietary market evolved and developed, which came out with, a lot more information and a lot faster information, a lot of things that became very essential to a vast majority of the flow that's traded in our markets today. And so the infrastructure release is basically saying, we have to modernize this. We have to bring it forward. We have to, add more content. We should have, more information on odd lots and high price stock, because there's a lot of liquidity in there. We should have, more content in terms of either auction information or depth of book. And we should bring competition into the equation here. We should, we really, the exclusive processor model, I don't think has worked in terms of bringing in the kind of competitive forces that stimulate innovation and stimulate, whether it's innovation or pricing, what have you. Competitive forces are generally a good thing. So, you know, competing consolidators and the other things we're doing. These are all things that we're trying to accomplish through these three things. And we're hopeful that, you know, that with the public process and engagement and very deliberate process, that we may be able to end up with a better market model for data and infrastructure going forward.
Great. Mike, Joanna, are there areas here of, you know, that you'd highlight, or are there any areas of concern with these proposals?
So I'm happy to kick off. Brett and I have been discussing market data for years, and basically I agree with everything that Brett just said. I even bid on the SIP and the Opera data feed when that was out for RFP a few years ago. That said, it's my job, I think, on this panel to cause a little bit of trouble and, you know, raise the fact that I think about markets globally and holistically across asset classes. So while I understand completely that the SIP is the first step for market data discussions, option participants have to be considered because they have to take in, and that's where I wrote most of my algos, both the SIP and OPRA data fees for both regulatory surveillance purposes as well as trading, which is a multi-million dollar price tag in and of itself. So while I agree with everything that Brett said, the options industry really needs to be considered. We're at a loss for market makers. We're under 10 at this point. The market data costs alone have created a barrier to entry into options, and they have this, they suffer from the exact same issues, and they need to be considered as overall health of the market. And the market participants, it's very important that market participants have different risk appetites and profiles. We don't want fewer of them, especially in this type of market.
Great. Mike?
So where to start? let's start with the low hanging fruit here. I think many of us have been focused on governance issues for years. After it was on the 10-year anniversary of the flash crash that the SEC voted unanimously to adopt that final order, certainly a better May 6, 2020 than it was May 6, 2010. And when I was giving some internal updates to folks who had been at Citi for a long, long time, and I said, you know, we've been after this as an industry for a decade, they said I was lowballing that number. So to say that that was a major, major accomplishment is an understatement. Many people, myself included, didn't really think that it would actually get passed. And so, you know, what I think is unfortunate is that obviously as the as time progresses, you're having you know, those with interests that are not necessarily aligned with the rest of the industry you know, kind of combating these things. And so, you know, we saw NASDAQ file a stay on the order, which the SEC summarily denied. I find that perplexing because we've had very constructive dialogue with NASDAQ. I thought their blueprint, their total markets blueprint, which I believe came out in April of last year, so just over a year ago, I seem to recall them being proponents of industry representation on the SIP operating committees. And so for them to turn around at this point, I understand it, and I understand that it's more than just the representation, but it strikes me as frustrating. And that now sits in the DC circuit courts. On infrastructure, I generally agree with most of what Brett outlined. And I think the industry generally, at least through my discussions with buy side, sell side, you know, is generally supportive of most of what's in the infrastructure proposal. What's gonna be at issue, and I think you're seeing this through the comment process, is really, you know, adding content, adding competition makes sense to most. Bolstering core data makes sense to most. Auction and balance information, depth of book, not really that controversial, but odd lots, that does raise a lot of controversy, in particular around order protection and should they be protected or not. And I think there's, you know, pros and cons to each direction. I don't know that there's a per se right answer to that question, but, you know, what is the path of least resistance? What I'm hearing often in the industry is, since we agree with at least 75% of what's being proposed here, how do we get this through? How do we get the market data portions of this pushed through while perhaps tabling some of the order protection issues, if that's even possible? So that's generally been the feedback that I've heard on the infrastructure proposal. But to Brett's point, it's now incumbent upon the industry to respond. You know, we've responded in writing. The comment period is closed. But I think now it's ever more important to have those calls with SEC, you know, the chairman, the commissioners, the staff, and really explain both sides, or there's probably more than two sides to this issue. You know, I know retail looks at it quite differently than institutions, and then even within the institutional community, there's a whole lot of shades of gray. So that's really where I'd like to see us focus some of our time and attention going forward, so that we can actually push through what are the majority of which are very constructive changes to core data.
Changes.
Yes, please.
Sorry, just very quickly. I appreciate your comments, Joanna, and we don't have too many people saying that we're not trying to do enough, but taking on the options data world would be an interesting challenge as well. And I think depending on what happens in equities, it certainly seems to me like there's room for something to be done there down the road. We just had to pick and choose where to start here. And that's not messaging, we're doing anything there, but I get your point. And with the, you know, with Mike, we tried to punt. I mean, we basically tried to avoid, I think, and I choose my words carefully, but order protection wasn't the, you know, the focus. It was that we need to show more information and we want to leave order protection alone. And so we were trying to figure out how we could get more information on that inside quote activity out there, leaving the protected quote at 100 shares, right? And what I think a lot of people miss is that most of the firms, I mean, for institutions like your brokers, they're getting direct feeds. They have access to all the odd lot quotes. They have the ability to make best execution every day in every trade looking at odd lot information. So in some respects, that doesn't change. For an institutional trader who's making a best ex decision when they look at an alphabet or an apple or whatever, and they're trying to figure out, you know, how do I interact with liquidity that's inside of that 100 share quote? And the NBBO issue for retail, right? Retail is not seeing a lot of this liquidity, and they're not getting measured against it in their 605, and, you know, and they might miss it, right? There could be a 50 share offer at, you know, a nickel and a 100 share offer at a dime. And they could get traded at 9 cents. It counts as price improvement. You know, somebody could have a 40 share order, right? They trades through the, you know, the 50 share offer at a nickel, trades at 9 cents, gets counted as a penny price improvement. And, you know, and is that really price improvement? And that's how our world works today, right? We're counting that as price improvement and not showing or giving that execution to the retail investor. So there's some things that are important to solve here, and it's complicated, and these things all link together, but we're trying our best to piece it together in a meaningful way. And again, we will continue to mull over all those detailed issues, Mike.
Great. I clearly hear there's that concern around the retail investor and what do they see and how do they interact with the market. There's been a lot of industry and speculation in the press around what is driving the markets today. We saw that there is stories around Robinhood and others driving the markets or potentially driving some of this volatility. What is your view on that? I'll go to you, Mike, first.
Well, you know, the data is pretty staggering when you look at, you know, what you can slice it a number of different ways. We often try to try to figure out what is the segmentation going on in the market. How much of this activity is being driven by institutions, long onlys, hedge funds, retail, market makers around retail, high frequency. You know, these are age old debates. But if you just, you know, you look at the number of new retail accounts opened just this year, and especially since people have been working from home and, you know, frankly, they're sitting by their computers, they're sitting in front of CNBC all day long. You know, most of us who work on trading floors have CNBC on all day long, but for a lot of people, this is new to be in your home and watch, you know, watch a lot of upheaval going on in the world in many ways. And looking at the markets as a real-time barometer of that. And now it's free to trade. And people are getting very interested. And it seems to me that there has been an elevated level of retail trading in the market. Some are saying not to the likes of which we haven't seen in 20 years. And you know, that's there are other indicia. I mean, you look at the amount of off exchange trading, which to me says that, you know, that oftentimes a lot of the retail market making flow is not hitting the exchange, it's being traded off exchange, and TRF volumes are going up. And however you're looking at it, you know, it seems unmistakable to many of us that there are some forces, unique forces going on in this market, obviously, but beyond just high volume, high volatility, it's really who's in the market. And and frankly, people are concerned, you know, and I don't know that there's a silver bullet or anything to be done about it. But those of us who remember a dot-com bubble burst wonder, you know, are we looking at something similar to that now? So, you know, I don't know that there is, I don't know how much of that is fact, and there's debates going on all over the street around that. So I wonder if there's a particular regulatory slant on that.
Well, that was going to be my next question. Brett, I'm sure you guys are closely following what's going on out there. Are there any views that you can share with us about the impact of retail on the current market?
So we're first and foremost, we try to look at the data, and the data does suggest that the contribution of retail has gone up meaningfully. You can see it through the TRF, you know, the TRF data, and that's been confirmed in conversations with wholesalers. You know, it also would appear that in some cases that while the retail's gone up, there's been sometimes institutional a little bit less. Sometimes you can see that through the percentage of flow going into the closing auction, right? So we've looked at those dynamics, and you know, look, it's okay for there to be more retail. I mean, you got a lot of people who are sitting at home, and they, you know, they don't have anything to do, and the you know, there's a lot of, you know, I jokingly say, you know, there a lot of things are closed, right? They can't do a lot of different things, and so this has become a passive, and it's free, right? There's free trading, zero commissions. But from a regulatory perspective, we keep our eyes on the same things that we do normally, right? We want to make sure that retail investors are being treated fairly, that they're not being taken advantage of. We look very closely at, you know, what's going on, you know, in our 606, which we can talk about later, but in our 606 disclosures, we have enhanced disclosures now for retail brokers to talk about, you know, you can see some of the numbers out there in terms of payment for order flow, where orders are being routed. And we have a, you know, we have this in the 606 disclosure, they're supposed to disclose if you ever make a deal where you trade off best execution for payment for order flow, you have to specify the details of those arrangements, right? And that's very clear, footnote 397, if anybody's looking for the exact footnote. Mm-hmm. But it's important. It's important enough that we tweeted about it and we've talked about it and we will continue to do so. So those are the things that we're looking at. And, you know, and obviously there's been some more news lately about retail investors getting involved in, say, maybe a bankrupt company, things like that, right? And so we are concerned about how some of those things happen. And anywhere where we think that a retail investor might be getting hurt in any way, we're going to be looking very closely at it.
Great. You've mentioned 606, Brett. Let's go ahead and pivot a bit to that. So we know that there has been new updated Rule 606, including 606B3. Joanna, what are the new dates? So I know we've updated 606A to Brett's point on retail disclosures. What is the rationale around 606B3? What's going on there?
All right. So lots of dates, always exciting to talk about on a call. They're all online, so that's easy to find. 606A started in January 2020. It's aggregate public reports for routing held orders and NMS stocks and orders for option contracts of less than 50K. That had an exception through May 29th, so that's live. 606B for broker dealers responding to detailed specific order handling disclosures for NMS stock orders submitted on non-held basis that outsource routing. So that's so easy to say, it just rolls off the tongue. The SEC did, and thank you, Brett, because a little bit of sanity in my life goes so much so far, or if I have any left. The SEC did extend the deadline until July 29th with the collection data requirement that just started on June 1st. Please note that the self-routing broker dealer is under 606B. do not, that do routes on their own are not exempt, and that did start with January 1st this year. So I don't know if that answers your question. Riveting stuff.
I believe it, yeah. No, it's important because there's this, again, unless you're deeply in the weeds and are spending every day on it, knowing what is the differential between a self-routing firm, an outsourced routing firm, or a white-labeled routing firm, and what those dates are, and when the buy side can anticipate being able to request that enhanced data. Brett, you mentioned the enhanced 606 reports that are out there. Those have started to show up from Q1 that were extended the reporting until May 29th. So I think that's where some of these stories that we're seeing in the press have started to come from. What does the SEC expect either the routing firms or the retail firm, retail traders themselves, how can they use this data to better their experience in the marketplace?
And look, you know, transparency is a, you know, it's a great thing, but the chairman has always said that transparency is one of the, you know, one of the key principles for his markets agenda. More information means better decisions. You know, people should be, you know, I've always wondered how many retail investors go and they look at, you know, their effective over quoted spread, market quality per execution, right? So in many respects, it's on the obligation of the broker to be thinking about how they're providing execution quality to their customers. I mean, just from what you've seen recently, right? I just saw a bunch of stuff on Twitter today, I think, or yesterday, that was looking at some of this new data that was put out there, and people are having a conversation and looking at you know, how this looks. It facilitates a discussion about best execution, and ultimately, you know, retail investors should be able to make better and more informed decisions based upon that. So I'm hopeful that that, you know, whether it's the broker, the wholesaler, the industry generally, or all the way down to the retail investor, that more transparency will just help lead to better outcomes. And, you know, obviously information is the first place to start in terms of catalyzing that to happen.
Right. And then with the 606B3 for the institutional side, I would anticipate then that the expectation would be for the buy side to use it in a similar fashion.
You know, so the early, you know, I had somebody tell me that they're not getting a ton of requests yet for this data. And so, you know, I was actually thinking about this, right? For institutions, like, ask for it. Like, it's, you ask for it and you get it. There are going to be smaller institutions who might not get everything that the big, like, you know, like part of the idea was probably the big banks are giving a lot of information to a lot of people, especially the big clients, maybe not the same amount to everybody, right? And it could be that a smaller asset manager isn't getting a lot of information that one of the top 50 accounts at the big bank is getting, right? And so this says there's at least a baseline of information that everybody should get. Everybody should have access to this information, and it should inform how you do your business, right? And so I encourage people to ask for it and to look at it. There's some new stuff in there, right? I know, having looked at, you know, sort of order routing and TCA reports in the past, there wasn't always the sort of unfilled order aspect, not just where are you executing, but where are you routing? And there's a lot of information there in terms of how those routes work. So I think there's a lot of useful information there. I hope people use it and learn from it and benefit, and then it helps, you know, institutional investors figure out how to, you know, better refine their conversations with their brokers and ultimately the execution quality of their orders.
And Mike, on your side, are you seeing those early requests?
So I think Brett, you're spot on. You know, there hasn't been a deluge of requests coming in for these reports yet. You know, I still think it's early, and I still think there's a whole third party vendor world that has sprung up around this, and I do expect those requests to come in. But, you know, to your point, for a firm like Citi, with some of our largest institutional customers, we have been and will continue to give whatever level of detail they want to consume. And so what I think the brilliance of this regulatory initiative was to level the playing field. And to your point about some smaller asset managers who may not have even known what to ask for in the past, they now have a template, and a template that includes not only where they were executed, but where their orders were shown. And I think that is the real positive and plus to this initiative, even if we haven't seen the requests come in from some of our larger clients in force just yet. If I can pivot to today's news, one of the things that I was most excited about in talking with my clients and having for years explained to them and asked them to trust me that we are routing virtually agnostic as to rebate. And I say virtually only because it's not as though it's not a factor in how we route, but it's, you know, number 14 on a list of 14. And I was looking forward to having the data behind this to prove that statement. And I think the combination of institutional 606 with a transaction fee pilot would have fostered some really, really good productive conversations with our clients. Unfortunately, we saw today yet another, I think, a very activist move by the DC Circuit Court to essentially table the transaction fee pilot, remand it back to the SEC. And I for one am frustrated by that. I think the industry spoke in loudly and in unison. And by my quick read of the opinion that just came out today and the concurring opinion, you know, I think there were some things that naturally, you know, a three judge panel is not going to appreciate as much as those who do this for a living every day, be they in Washington, New York, Boston, or elsewhere. So that's a little bit frustrating. I think the real benefit of the 606 reports would have come in conjunction with the transaction fee pilot. And that looks like it's at least on hold for the time being.
Brett, not sure. Go ahead, Joanna, please.
Buy side. So I do a lot of work for the buy side clients, and under the SEC examinations, recent examination requirements, they have a best ex due diligence requirement. So there are policies and procedures in the buy side now where they've been taking the TCA from Citibank for years, and they have to now embed that in their current policies and procedures. So all of my clients will be getting their updated 606B request, but one, most hedge funds have one or two people who would be able to deal with this data to begin with. And two, they're all working from home. So, and they need to update their policies and procedures and think about how they're going to look at the firm existing TCA reports that they're currently looking at and the new 606B data and how they're going to embed that into real due diligence processes to determine how they're routing orders. So I think they're coming, at least my clients, they're definitely coming. And they're going to have all the nuances that you're going to expect from me. So there you go. But for the buy side, I definitely wouldn't. I've been saying that they should have them for their SEC exams.
Very good. Thank you. Talking about regulatory initiatives. So we have the transaction fee pilot, which the DC court did remand back to the SEC. And again, brief review since that just came out today. It appeared the one of the primary prongs of that was the SEC had taken, I would call it, the empirical approach. We're not entirely certain what the outcome might be, but we'd like to gather some data. And if I read correctly, the court's answer to that was, no, you have to have a end goal in mind, and then you can look for the data. I'm not sure if that's the standard everybody would agree, but that seems to be what they were implicating in the opinion. Brett, not sure if you can speak to that or not, and if not, we can look at other things.
Well, believe it or not, I've had a back-to-back day, and I haven't read either of the opinions yet. But I used to say for people who hate pilots, you know, look at MIFID, right? Or and there's regulators could go in and they could just proceed ahead with what they think without really trying to collect data and landing at the right spot based upon empirical data, or not. And you heard, how often were you hearing, for years when people talked about market structure, talking about, it's going to be data driven, it's going to be empirically based, right? So there's that. And I think also in the decision there was a lack of assertion I think in the final pilot that there was a problem. So we're going to find out exactly what the problem is. And you know, I mean, personally, I think there was an issue, and maybe that, you know, maybe who knows, maybe that could have been stated more strongly and that would have helped, but it is what it is. We've got a lot going on. You know, we're not going to let the grass grow under our feet. There's plenty of other things to focus on, and we will continue with our various efforts here.
Great. Well, mentioning other things, we do have CAT. So the consolidated audit trail, we're looking towards go live, my goodness, next week. So lots going on with the CAT as well. What industry issues, Mike, Joanna, or Brett, do you see that need to be dealt with now that we are literally days away from going live with the industry reporting?
I'm happy to start us off. To Brett's point on transparency, you know, who's going to argue against transparency? This has been a long time coming. Another 10-year anniversary. I think CAT was originally proposed in late May of 2010, and you know, so it's a decade later. We've done an awful lot of work to get ready for implementation. Net, a very good thing. It does raise the same old issues, the same issues around. The breakdown of authority between SROs, exchanges, and FINRA on the one hand, FINRA as the CAT processor, and brokers on the other hand. You know, I still think that PII is a juicy target for cyber risk. And if and when there is a breach, who's responsible will become the issue. There was a lot of industry discussion around this in the CAT reporter agreement, which the SROs required firms to sign back at the end of last year in order to start industry testing. There was a lot of pushback on that. It had a ridiculously low liability limit included. So you were obligated to test and implement this regulatory requirement, but in doing so, you signed away all of your rights, even though as brokers, we really don't have the ability to control the safety and security of that information in the same way that the SROs do. Ultimately, that was resolved in favor of the industry. That liability limit of, I think it was $500, was dropped from the CAT reporter agreement. But I've seen this movie before. I think at the end of the day, the doctrine of regulatory immunity is a pretty powerful one. And this is a regulatory initiative. I have no doubt that if there's a breach of the CAT, that the SROs will claim regulatory immunity from suit, that they were just doing what they needed to do pursuant to their regulatory responsibilities, and that liability is going to shift the industry, and that's a frightening thing. I also worry about duplicative regulatory inquiry, surveillance, from all of the SROs having access to this data. So there are concerns. We voice them, but it's at the end of the day, it's time to get going. I think the CAT is long overdue, and will hopefully serve a very useful function in the markets.
With respect to that PII, Joanna, I think you had some thoughts there.
I have lots of thoughts. Nobody usually wants to hear them, but I'll try concisely. My biggest concern, I think we've all talked about the processor. My biggest concern remains, and where I spent the most time the last few months, is at the firms. I'm concerned about the firms holding the PII data and what they're doing to protect these reports internally, because they're going to use this, or their reliance on vendors. I know from having done a number of different regulatory reports, from LOPR and OATS to electronic blue sheets and swaps reviews, that most firms rely on vendors. And most firms relying on those vendors have gaps in their compliance processes. And they require that the vendor solutions to be complete, but their vendor solutions don't feed into their enterprise risk management processes for security. So my biggest concern for CAT to date, other than the things that we've been talking about ad nauseum with Brett, and he doesn't want to hear from me anymore on this topic, is what are the firms doing to secure their own PII data internally with regards to CAT data? I miss seeing everybody, it's true. And I'd be happy once we're open to take everybody out to cocktails and to hear about your tiresome family problems, and I can vet my own Zoom issues. But what I don't want to do is talk about acronyms, and I don't want to talk about GDPR and New York State or California regulatory data or security requests anymore. PII data is not just a CAT issue, and I think firms need to start treating it as such. LOPR data has CAT, your electronic blue sheets has PII data, they all do. And I think that firms need to start thinking about that from an enterprise risk management perspective. Compliance protocols need to be included.
I think that's those are words of wisdom. I know we've actually run over a little bit of our allotted time. I do want to say, you know, just a word or two. We had a couple of other issues we wanted to hit on really quick. We know that there's a new exchange entrant coming in, hopefully in September with MEMX. We may have another with MEMX Pearl Equities. At this stage, MEMX has their Form 1 improved, and I believe the comment period for the MEMX Pearl Equities was over on June 8th, and there weren't any comments as far as I'm aware. Do we expect that to follow through in the normal course, Brett?
Generally, we don't say a lot about, you know, open items like that before the commission. So, you know, that application remains under review. I will say that, you know, we've got, you know, now long-term stock exchange, MEMX, also MEMX Pearl were, you know, rivaling the options markets for a lot of exchanges. It's great to see innovation. I think that, you know, we do need to think about the broader forces at play in terms of creating so many markets, and just remain vigilant in terms of how we think about how this whole thing extends. But no, I wouldn't say much about that one market in particular.
I think that's fair, and that actually ties. Sorry, Mike, go ahead.
Well, we took a look. Citi, obviously, you know, we took a look at all three exchanges we have for the past year, been in constant dialogue with them. We just announced last week our investment in MEMX, and in large part, you know, it's for a number of reasons. I think their story has been pretty widely told. But what's relevant here is I think what the regulatory initiatives that we've seen come out of the commission for the past several years have been driving towards is a lot of the same things that MEMX is trying to drive from a commercial standpoint. You know, can we run markets more transparently, more efficiently? You know, I think it's telling that at least two of the three markets, from my conversations with both MEMX and MIAX, are not planning to charge for market data initially. You know, I think that's in and of itself is telling, even if their longer term plan is to charge for market data. I think these new entrants are at least giving a nod to the fact that there seems to be some, you know, it's no surprise to say that there's a lot of industry clamor around a number of things that have existed among the incumbent exchanges for quite some time. And, you know, I think I think competition in this respect is a good thing. You know, if you feel like some segment of the market is tone deaf to some of these issues and others are more willing to listen, then, you know, that seems to be something that we should and could get behind. But to Brett's point, we're now at 16 exchanges. This is, you know, it's a fragmentation nightmare. And there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of incentive to stop. You know, I think the governance order limiting the number of votes on an operating committee for any one exchange group was a really good first step at sort of getting rid of that perverse incentive. But I think from a commercial standpoint, you know, it could potentially get too large to manage. And certainly having two or three exchanges go live this fall in an environment like the one we're in, it poses challenges. I mean, we'll work through them, but it definitely poses challenges from an infrastructure perspective.
Let me pick up on one thing, and this will be where we wrap up. So Mike, you mentioned the market data fees. So recently, NYSE National had filed from not having direct market data fees to filing for them. That was up before the SEC. The SEC has sent that back and asked for a fairly significant amount of information and also opened that up for comment, notice and comment from the industry. Brett, I know there's a large discussion around platform competition and a number of items the SEC would like. let me ask you, you know, is there anything you'd like to highlight in that request for information from the industry? And then we'll go ahead and wrap it up after that.
Yeah, so thanks for that, Shane. Let me just say this. So as you also know, in our, you know, we recently did not prevail in litigation generally related to market data fees. And people have asked me as well, you know, how do we look at what's happening in the fee landscape as a result of all of this? And I would say that, you know, it's interesting, that decision was a very, very narrow decision. It was essentially a process issue, right? It was under 19D for a generally applicable fee, you cannot file a denial of access claim. Okay. That's what they said. They didn't address, you know, a lot of the questions that were potentially there, which was, you know, is there sufficient competition such that there, you know, market forces are at play, so you won't, you know, won't result in, you know, super competitive profits and, you know, and those sorts of problems, and therefore you could deny. So that was never decided. So the court kind of kicked it back. They said, well, the SEC can still suspend fees. And we also still have the Susquehanna decision before us, which basically says that the committee, you know, simply stating that there's competition or that they're fair and reasonable or a lot of things like that doesn't cut it. You have to really, you know, understand, it has to be demonstrated, right? And so that's the backdrop. And I think this is in some respects just an illustration of that's what we should be doing. That's our job, is to, you know, when something comes in, to ask those questions. If somebody says, no, there's competition, it's because of platform theory, we have to say, well, you know, actually, there's a lot of views on both sides of that. And so in this particular case, it's saying, okay, if, you know, if you're going to assert that, then demonstrate it. How would you demonstrate that? And here are some of the things that you could demonstrate. So I would just point out that this particular request for additional information on a fee filing is, I think, the most, you know, it's fairly extensive and it's detailed, and it's talking about this. It's showing that we're trying to get at this. We're still working at it, and we're trying to get at this information. And I would also point out, Shane, that it wasn't a staff request. It was commission request. So this is something that happened at the commission level, and it came out. So it just shows you how, you know, how important this is to the commission as a whole. So we are continuing down that path. We're still trying to get that job done, and that's just the latest example.
Outstanding. Well, let me thank you all again for participating. Everybody who joined us today, Brett, Mike, Joanna, I think this has been a fabulous conversation. I could go on for another hour or two easily, but I'll let everybody get back to their day. Thank you. And again, please reach out to Greenwich if there's any questions you'd like to have, and we'll do our best to answer them for everybody. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
All right. See you.